Great job, kids. What an encouraging message to that song. Let's all begin service today and stand and sing Hosanna. This is a new song to us. I'm not certain if we've done this one here before. If so, it's been a while. But we've got Easter coming. And before Easter, Palm Sunday. And I wanted to teach this song to us because I want to sing this on Palm Sunday later on as the triumphal entry of our King and our God. Let's sing this song, Praise is Rising.
Praise is rising, eyes are turning to you, we turn to you. Hope is stirring and hearts are yearning for you, we long for you. When we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away.
Of every way among
Amen. Great singing, everybody. Welcome to church this evening. So glad to see each of you here. You may be seated.
Thank you for singing. I enjoyed that song. I enjoyed our young kids singing that song. I kept waiting for Abby's drum set to rise up in the air and start spinning. Some of you guys who have been and seen the Newsboys in person know what I'm talking about. Duncan, they have a drum set, the Newsboys who sing that song. And when they get in there, that drum set will rise up in the air. It'll turn sideways. And he is strapped in. And it starts spinning. And he's playing drums while it's spinning. Duncan, the guy that plays the drums for Newsboys, is kind of crazy. But I've seen him do that two or three times. And it's an awesome thing to see. So I was just looking over at Abby waiting for it to start spinning around. So we'll have to work on that concoction there. So we'll see what happens. Don't forget to take a bulletin with you. Look at it. There's several things in the upcoming events that will be happening. Our junior visitation tomorrow night, so all of our kids in grades 1 through 6, you are invited to come and be a part of that, bring some money for supper, and then Brother Daniel and Ms. Casey are having sleepover time, and one of the boys over here in the Family Life Center, the girls over at Casey's house, and so all the kids are invited, the teens are invited to be a part of that, and then our young adults have a game night this Saturday night at Brittany Harriet's house, so all of our young people are invited to be young adults are invited to be a part of that as well, so looking forward to that. There's other stuff on here. There's things will be coming up. I'm not going to go through every single thing, but please look at your bulletin and know what's happening and know what's going on. Continue to pray for those who are sick, those that are not feeling well. Mr. Tom Farron, his surgery this week, so pray for him as he goes through this. Pray that it'll happen, that things will go smoothly, and that he'll find some relief from the pains that he's been going through. So we need to keep him in prayer. Also, Miss Betty Dixon called, and she has a niece named Wanda Acosta, who's been diagnosed with leukemia. So she's in the Greenville Hospital, so please keep Wanda Acosta in your prayers. This is Miss Betty Dixon's niece, so I'm sure she'd appreciate you praying for her. Let's pray, and we'll ask God to be in our service tonight. God, thank you so much for all that you do for us. God, thank you for giving us this church to be a part of. Thank you for the music that can inspire us and point us to you. So, God, we thank you that you're not dead, that you're surely alive. So, God, we thank you for all that you do for us. And, God, be with the prayer requests that have been mentioned, Lord. I pray for Mr. Tom as he has his surgery this week. I pray that things will go smoothly through the week, so that it'll all happen the way it's supposed to, and that, God, he'll have that surgery and things will be taken care of. God, I just thank you for all that you do for us. God, we love you. We thank you for who you are. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's lift up the Lord's name and praise one more time this evening. Praise him, praise him. Stand with me and sing. And praise your God. Amen.
Praise him, praise him. Jesus, our blessed Redeemer. Sing, O earth, his wonderful love proclaim. Hail him, highest archangels in glory. Strength and honor get to his holy name. Like a shepherd, Jesus will guard his children, and in his arms he carries them all day long. Praise him, tell of his excellent grace.
should be praising him, one, ever, forever, continually in joyful song. That means now, and that means when we walk out of these doors, and then in joyful song, when we sing, it shouldn't be uncommon for us to smile. Amen? As we think of Jesus and all he's done for us. Let's bow to him in prayer real quick, and we'll continue on with our service. Father in heaven, thank you so much for being our God and for being so worthy of our praise. Lord, as we said this morning, all sorts of different things want to be our King, but only you are fully deserving of that title. And Lord, this evening, we gather together and ascribe to you all glory and majesty and power, which are all yours. And we confess that to you, God. Lord, help us to, in our hearts, place you there, the place of kingship of our lives, that if you tell Bobby Berry to do something, I'm going to do it. If you tell any of us in here to do something, Lord, we should all trust you enough by now to obey without a second thought. Help us, Lord, to be eager for what you have to tell us and to want to serve you and to serve you with joy, real joy that only comes from you, our King. We love you for being our Savior and our King, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you so much for singing, everybody. Please be seated at this time. Brother Brian Burroughs is going to come and sing a special for us.
Before I sing, y'all know my parents, and I'm very grateful for them doing what they have for me over the past couple of years. I've faltered. There was a time when I was doing a leader in my youth group back up in Maryland. I wanted to be a youth minister, and I went forward with it. But Satan put stumbling blocks in front of me, and I faltered. I failed him. I even got so desperate that I did things I normally wouldn't do. And eventually I came down here to my parents, who helped me restart my life all over again. And I'm trying to make my life good for God. And this weekend, actually yesterday, I got news that a close friend of mine just passed away. And I've talked with him. I knew that he knew of God, but I didn't know if he knew God the way I do. I didn't know if he accepted Jesus as personal Savior. And much like the messages that we've had over the past couple weeks, this really hit me hard. And I'm not doing my part. I'm just sitting back. I'm not doing anything. I've been waiting for far too long for God to come and step into my life and say, hey, let's go, let's move, let's do this. When he says he equips those that are called, I went, I got equipped, but I faltered. It was my fault. So now here I am trying to rebuild myself, and I'm waiting on God to help me move along. Taking every step in obedience while I'm waiting. I will serve you while I'm waiting. I will worship while I'm waiting. I will not faint. I'll keep running the race, even while I wait.
I'm waiting on you, Lord, though it's not easy, no, but faithfully I will wait. Yes, I will wait. I will move ahead, bold and confident, taking every step in obedience. While I'm waiting, I will serve you. While I'm waiting, I will worship. While I'm waiting, I will not fail. I'll keep running the race, even while I wait. I will ahead, bold and confident. I'll be taking every step in obedience. Yeah, while I'm waiting, I will serve you. While I'm
appreciate that. It's tough following God. Let me tell you, there's a lot of bumps and side roads that come along the way, and it can be tough. And it's interesting that he would share that testimony tonight that kind of goes along with what I want to share with us tonight. I want to talk tonight about relentless pursuit. Relentless pursuit. Now, if you think about the word relentless, relentless is not a word that you probably use very often. I mean, how many of you can remember this week using the word relentless in a sentence? Russ, all right? Russ is the only one. I'm probably sure he probably did. Oh, you did? Okay, so I had two of you. Okay, so two people did. So that's good. That's not a lot of people compared to who we have here tonight. So many times, though, when we do use the word relentless, we use it in a negative context. We may say something like, this rain is just relentless. Or we may just, with what's going on around us right now, the relentless boredom of being in quarantine. It won't stop. It's just so boring. But relentless is more than just someone or something being overbearing or something being pushy. It's more than that. It's a lot more than that, actually. Relentless describes someone who is unstoppable, who is energized, who is enduring, never giving up, always on. You ever know somebody that's just always on? I got asked this morning, I don't know what it was, but I got asked this morning how many Pepsis I had before church. I only had less than half of a little, well, it wasn't even a 20 ounce, it was a small one. I don't know, but sometimes you could just always be on. It can wear you out. But have you ever heard of Jake Olson? Jake Olson played for the University of Southern California football in 2017 and 2018. Has anybody in here ever heard of him? Okay, two of them. Okay, so not very many people have heard of that one either. Jake Olson, from the age of 12, Jake had dreamed of playing football, and specifically for USC, the University of Southern California. But the problem is that Jake had a rare form of cancer that's called retinoblastoma. Have you ever heard of that? I had never heard of it. Before his first birthday, Jake had lost one of his eyes. At the age of 12, he lost his other eye. Before he lost his second eye at the age of 12, he had gone to actually watch a practice at the USC football stadium. And he watched the teams just practicing, and not long after that, he lost his other eye. His dream of playing football was over, or at least we would assume that his dream of playing football would be over. But here's the thing, Jake was relentless. He was unstoppable. He refused to give up on his dream. He didn't let no eyes stop him from following his dream. He decided that he would be a long snapper. And that he would he'd work on punts and extra points because he couldn't see, but he could snap a ball. If you understand what a long snapper is, in football you have the center who is there with the football and when they're all lined up, and he's the one that puts his hands on the football and he hikes it to the quarterback. Well, the long snapper is the one when they're going to kick a field goal or they're going to punt it, he's the one that gets there, puts his hands on the football, and he slings it back 15 yards to the guy that's kicking the ball. So that's all he has to do is long snap. And I remember a boy in high school in North Little Rock when we lived in North Little Rock. He was not the greatest football player, but he said, "I can long snap." And so he worked on that, and I watched him through high school doing long snap. And he did that a lot. So Jake decided that he would practice, and he worked at this long snapping position. He made, actually, his varsity football team as a long snapper when he was a junior in high school. So he made it to his football team in high school. Because he was relentless and he never gave up on his dream, he went to play football for USC in 2017 and 2018. And I want you to watch this short little video.
USC has a blind snapper, and his name is Jake Olson. And there may be some communication going on right now between the USC and Western Michigan coaches to alert them that the Trojans are about to put him in to snap this extra point. And he snaps some kicks at USC spring games, but he's never done this in a live football game. So here he is.
So Jake Olson, how about this for an inspirational moment? He is out there snapping. And a good snap from Jake. Listen to the crowd. Look at the USC sideline. What a moment. Look at the excitement right there from Jake Olson.
Now look, we aren't here tonight. That's an awesome story. But look, we're not here tonight to talk about being relentless on the football field. We could do that and talk about football and sports. I love sports. I love football. But we're not here to talk about that tonight. But you should have this same sort of relentless passion when you're pursuing God. You should pursue God with everything. When life hands you blindness, you should say, "I'm not going to let that stop me. I'm still going to follow God." Whatever it is that gets thrown at you, you're going to pursue God with everything that you have. How can we relentlessly pursue Christ? How can we be unstoppable? How can we be energized, never giving up on our pursuit of God? And that's what I hope to look at for the next couple of Sunday nights as we go into this little series on being relentless pursuit. But before we can ever consider pursuing God, which is what we should be doing, we should be pursuing God. But before we can consider that, it's important that we understand, listen, that God has relentlessly pursued us. See, we're supposed to be relentlessly pursuing him, but we have to understand that he did that for us. And I want to go through that tonight. In a conversation that Jesus was having with the religious leaders of his day, he told them a series of stories, parables that we would call them. He told them a series of stories that help us understand how God relentlessly pursues us. And Jesus was telling this as a story because he was wanting people, the listeners of his day, he was wanting them to understand this. And so he puts this earthly story with a heavenly meaning together. And he puts it together so that they would understand. Listen, Jesus says, I want you to understand how much Jesus is, or God is pursuing you, how much he's coming after you. I want you to understand that. So we look in Luke chapter 15. In Luke chapter 15, it says, so he told them this parable. What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he has lost one of them, does not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? And when he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and his neighbors, saying to them, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost. Just so I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. See, he's trying to help us to understand how God is relentlessly pursuing us. And here we find Jesus is telling a story. Now, we all like a good story. I like a good story. I mean, a good story. I don't like a bad story, but I like a good story. And that's why the movie industry makes over $40 million a year, because, hey, people love to sit down and watch a story. How many of you guys watched any kind of movie this week? Since last Sunday, you've watched any kind of movie. One movie, two movies, I'm just a movie, all right? Most of you, a lot of you have. We like to be entertained. We like a story. How many of you read books? Yeah, a lot of you like to read books because of the story that could be in the book. You love to read the stories that are there. Well, Jesus told a story, but in Jesus' story, he has a spiritual message to it. It was not just for entertainment. It was not just to kind of, hey, here's something I can tell you for a few minutes, and you'll be all, oh, this is great, this is awesome, and then you go, wait. No, he was telling this because it has a spiritual meaning. See, when Jesus walked on this earth, there were shepherds who would live outside the town. Think about just going over the other side of the river, or just outside of town, and there'd be all these shepherds that were there, and they were taking care of the sheep, and they would watch out for the sheep. And in Jesus' story, he spoke of a shepherd who had 100 sheep. Now, in one manner, that seems like 100, that's not a terrible lot. But in another way, you think of 100, let's say we give you 100 sheep and say you take care of them. Then the 100 becomes, wow, that's a lot. There's a lot of sheep there. He had 100 sheep that he was in charge of. And the shepherd would feed his sheep. He would move them from place to place as needed so that they had plenty of grass, plenty of water. He had to make sure the water wasn't the rapidly running water because it would scare them. So he had to make sure that they had plenty of eat, something to drink. They had all the things that they need. A shepherd would also protect his sheep. We know in the Old Testament when it talks about David, and he was a shepherd boy, and when he was protecting his sheep, he fought lions to protect his sheep. He would risk his own life to save his sheep. This is his sheep, and you're not going to touch them. He was always trying to protect them. I got a visual of this one of my many trips to Bulgaria. We walked down to the Danube River. On the other side of that river, there is Romania. But as we were down there, right there on the Danube River, and we're looking at the river, there was a shepherd that came by. He had some sheep, he had some goats, they were all mixed together, but there was just one of him and all of these animals around him. And he had one little, thin little stick. He didn't have a big staff with a hook on the end of it. He just had his little stick. And that's him, actually. You can kind of see him down by the water if you can see the picture good enough. But he's down there by the water and he has a little stick. And he'd just go around and he'd make some kind of noises with his mouth. Again, it was Bulgarian, some of the stuff he'd say. I didn't understand what he's saying. But he would go through there and he'd say stuff and he'd just kind of tap someone. If they weren't doing what he wanted them to, he didn't smack them. He just kind of tap them and help them along. and they followed him. It was neat to see that visual of a shepherd out there taking care of his sheep. But in Jesus' day, each night, the shepherd would bring his sheep into a fenced area, and he would lay down across the doorway so that no sheep could get out and nothing else, good, bad, ugly, could get in. He was trying to protect his sheep. He was watching them. And as he was doing this, every night, he would do a head count. You ever done a head count before? I've been on many a trips with many a people in the church bus and different places that we went, and we'd always do a head count. We'd start counting. Before I'd even drive off, if I'm driving, I'd start walking through there and I'd count. And sure enough, there'd be one kid underneath a blanket somewhere, or one of them hiding in the floor, and I'd count, and I'd miss, I got to start over until I get the right number. When I take our senior adults, it's the same way. Most of the time, I'm waiting for Miss Lois to come out of the store. But, and you guys that go with us understand that's true. But Miss Lois is giving me the look. I'm in trouble. But he was doing a head count, and as he's doing a head count of all of his sheep, he notices something. I can imagine that he thought, hey, I must have just counted something wrong. I've done that. I know they're all on here. Quit moving. Be still for a second. Let me go through. So he does another head count. And he's going through there. And sure enough, he finds out that one of his sheep is not where it's supposed to be. Now, we, you and I today, we may think, what's the big deal? It's only one. It's only one sheep. Sheep are not the brightest animals anyway. He should have been here, right? But for this shepherd, every one of his sheep was very and extremely precious to him. So this shepherd, he left the pen where they were all in, and he goes out and he leaves the 99 there. He knows they're safe. They're probably going to sleep. They're in a pen. He'll probably put something in front of the gate there to make sure that they stay. And the shepherd goes out there and he goes to pursue the one. He goes out to pursue the one. And it wasn't like he just crossed the street to go find the lost animal. Now let me show you another picture here. These two guys give me some grief sometimes. I took this back when it snowed just a few weeks ago, whenever that was. And this is Buster and Moose. And Moose hasn't been around quite as long, but Buster has given me times where I have gone out there and yelled down the street for him not to come back. Well, not for him not to. But he didn't come back. I yelled only to have him not come back. I don't know for sure where he is. Abby and Sydney's out there, and they're walking down the streets. I get in my truck because, you know, hey, I got the driver's license. I'm going to drive. And so I get in the truck, and I'm driving down the road. I'm looking for Buster. Buster has said, hey, freedom, I'm not in the backyard anymore. I'm going to go explore. Wasn't too worried about cars. We didn't have a lot of traffic back in our neighborhood in Iron Creek subdivision. We didn't have a lot of traffic out there. So I wasn't too worried about it. But where is he? He needs to be here. And I go drive all over the little neighborhood looking for Buster, and I would see him. And when he saw me and he heard me, he didn't come running up to the truck and say, hey, look, hey, pop me back in the back and we'll just drive home. No, he goes, uh-oh, and he starts headed to the house. And when he gets to the house, by the time I turn around to do everything, he's in the garage wagging his tail like, ha, 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 what's going on? What's the big deal? I was here. Let me tell you. When a shepherd went looking for his sheep, that's not what he did. That's not the area that he was in, because the area that they lived in was more like this. Who knows where he's at? Has he gone over the hill on the other side? Is he underneath a bush somewhere? Has some other wild animal gotten him? What's going on? What's happening? Where is my sheep? In this case, the sheep was likely in the middle of nowhere. The shepherd had to relentlessly search. Sometimes it might even take him a couple days to find that one sheep. Now, would you give up and just say, that dumb sheep, he's going to come back. He knows where we're at. Or would you just keep going? I mean, if it was your dog, would you keep looking? You'd be out there searching and searching, and this shepherd was out there looking for his sheep. It was essential for him to do this because if he didn't, that sheep had no hope for survival. That sheep was not, he's not going to find food by himself. He's not going to find water by himself. He's going to think that that lion is his best friend. And he's going to go and get hurt. He's not going to survive without me. I have to help him. This shepherd was relentless in his pursuit, not letting anything get in his way of finding his little lost sheep. He has to find him. When he found his sheep, he wasn't going to let any chances of the sheep running off doing it again. And many times a shepherd would take the sheep and they would grab him by the legs, they'd pick him up and put him over their shoulders, hold on to their feet, and just walk back with him over their shoulders. You're not going to run away this time. I got you. Have you seen a lot of pictures I have of Jesus carrying a sheep over his shoulders? See, this is the picture that they want you to get. He's out there searching and looking for that one sheep, that one that needs the help. But I want you to also notice that he then celebrated the finding of the sheep with all of his friends. Now, listen, there's many times when I get Buster home and he gets a spanking. We don't read that this shepherd gave a spanking to his sheep. We read that when he got back, he had a celebration, a party, because his one sheep that was lost has now been found. Hey guys, look, I found him. That little booger gets out all the time, but I got him. He found him. He's here. But here's the thing. Here's the thing. Jesus followed up this story with another story that's similar to it. He says this. He says, "Or what woman, having 10 silver coins, if she loses one coin, does not light a lamp and sweep the house and seek diligently until she finds it? And when she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, 'Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that I had lost.'" And then our verse that I used this morning, "Just so I tell you, there is joy before the angels of God over one sinner who repents." See, Jesus follows up the story about the sheep with the story of a coin. Now, in this story, it isn't a sheep. You might not think it's a big deal. You ever dropped a penny in the Walmart parking lot and just said, "Leave it there"? Let me tell you, I'm a cheapskate sometimes, and many times I see your penny and I pick it up. I've always heard those stories. If it's on heads, it's good luck. If it's on tails, it's bad luck, so just leave it. But I don't care. I pick them up. I figure if I find money, that's good luck. And so I just pick them up, put it in my pocket. But I have seen people in the parking lot, they pull out their keys, and as they pull out their keys, a couple of pennies or a nickel or something falls out, and they just look. Now listen, I understand this whole concept of it's getting more and more difficult to get down there to pick it up. I understand that concept. But listen, it seems like that's just a lot of effort to go through for a coin. It's a lot of stuff to do, but here's the thing. What if it was a 1913 Liberty Head 5 nickel? Now you see this. This is a picture that I found of this Liberty Head nickel, 1913. And you know what? Let me tell you something. This coin is valued at $4.4 million. That one coin. Let me tell you something. You would probably be relentless in your pursuit if that was the coin that you dropped. You'd be all over it. You'd be looking for that coin. You'd want that coin back. The coin that this woman lost wasn't worth $4.4 million. But we do know that the losing of this coin, that she had lost a tenth of everything that she had. A tenth of everything that she had. The value of the coin was worth a day's wages. Now, that's a very significant loss. Think about this. Can you imagine working all day long? Whatever it was. Hot and sweaty, nasty. You've been working all day long, and at the end of the day, the boss man comes up and he writes you a check. And he gives you this check for your day's work. But somewhere between when he gave it to you and you got home, you've lost that check. You would be looking all over for that check, wouldn't you? You'd be in the car, digging around underneath everything, trying to find that check. You'd be searching all of your pockets, not once, but maybe five times. You would get back in your car and you would drive back to where he gave you the check, looking for the check. Whatever it was, you're going to go and find that check. You worked all day long for that check. I want that check. Now listen, when you lose something valuable like a paycheck or like cash or your phone or the TV remote, you begin to search until you find it. Do you remember? Some of you don't have a clue about it, and some of you know exactly. When I was growing up, I was the TV remote. You know? Hey, Darren, go turn to channel 4. Because it was only 4, 7, and 12. And then PBS, if you could find it. That was it. I mean, 4 channels. I mean, it wasn't too hard, but hey, I go up there and turn. And then you remember after you turn it, fixing the bunny ears? No, it wasn't a real rabbit, some of you young guys. It wasn't a real rabbit. But listen, it's particularly true that if you know that you had it yesterday. I know I just had it. I know it's somewhere around here. I know it's in this living room. Where is the remote? Where is it? Where did it go? Now, just the other day, I lost my cell phone in the house. I know it was in the house. Because I had used it in the house. Where was it in my house? I don't have a clue. Abby helped me. We were looking for my cell phone all over the house. Can you call it? No, it's on silent. We looked and looked. I never found it. I'm not even for sure when I was putting this together. I'm not even sure where Abby found it. Abby found it. She gave it back to me, but I don't remember where it was. Have you ever lost your glasses on the top of your head? And then you go searching for them? Well, listen. In Jesus' time, in Jesus' day, the floors were dusty in the house. There was no carpet. There was no tile. It was just dirt floors. The woman in this story could look around her house quickly and may never see it. She may never find it. But this woman didn't just look quickly around and say, oh, you know what? It's just one coin. The coin was too valuable for her to just forget about the coin. So she relentlessly pursued that coin. She was going to find that coin. Now listen, she lit candles so she could light up the room. She didn't have lights like this. She had to light candles. She probably began sweeping all over the house. She's looking closely along the floor. She's listening carefully for any sign that that coin just moved when I run the broom over it. She's trying to find this one coin. Now, I can imagine she probably got down on her hands and got down on her knees. I have done that looking for stuff. Looking under the table, looking under chairs, looking under the couch, trying to find this coin that was so valuable to her. But just like the shepherd, when she finally found the coin, she called her friends to come and celebrate. I found my coin! And they're going, yay! No. They were celebrating with her. They understood the value of that coin. They understood that it was something big. So what does this have to do with God relentlessly pursuing you? What is these two stories? What does it have to do with God pursuing us? See, Jesus told these stories to make the point that God pursues us much like the shepherd pursues his lost sheep and the woman sought after her lost coin. God comes and looks for us and searches for us relentlessly. He's coming after us. He has never, listen, with Brian's story, listen, he never gave up on Brian. He's never given up on any of you. Because, see, to God, you are extremely valuable. He don't quit. He pursues and follows and looks for you. I want you to hear just one more story that Jesus, that's in the Bible, about how Jesus relentlessly pursued, listen, one man. Jesus pursued relentlessly one man. And it's found in Mark chapter 5. It says this, they came to the other side of the sea, the country of Gerasenes. And when Jesus had stepped out of the boat, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit. He lived among the tombs, and no one could bind him anymore, not even with a chain. For he had often been bound with shackles and chains, but he wrenched the chains apart, and he broke the shackles in pieces. No one had the strength to subdue him. Night and day, among the tombs and on the mountains, he was always crying out and cutting himself with stones. And when he saw Jesus from afar, this is where it gets really cool. When he saw Jesus from afar, he ran and he fell down before Jesus. And crying out with a loud voice, he said, "What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I adjure you by God, do not torment me." This man is sitting there telling Jesus, "Don't come and torment me." For he was saying to him, Jesus was saying to him, "Come out of the man, you unclean spirit." Jesus knew what was going on here. He knew what was happening. And Jesus asked him, he said, "What is your name?" And he replied, "My name is Legion, for we are many." And he begged him earnestly not to send him out of the country. Now, a great herd of pigs was feeding there on the hillside. And they begged him, saying, "Send us into the pigs, let us enter them." So he gave them permission, and the unclean spirits came out and entered the pigs, and the herd, numbering about 2,000, rushed down the steep bank into the sea and drowned in the sea. Now, the herdsmen, the shepherds, they fled, and they told it in the city and in the country, and people came to see what is going on out here at the tombs. And they came to see Jesus and saw the demon-possessed man, the one who had the legion, sitting there, clothed and in his right mind. And then they were afraid. And those who had seen it described to them what had happened to the demon-possessed man and then what had happened to the pigs. And they began to beg Jesus, "Depart from our region, leave here." Now, that doesn't make sense, does it? But that's what they were begging him. Leave. And as Jesus was getting into the boat, the man who had been possessed with the demons begged him that he might be with him. And Jesus did not permit him, but said to him, "Go home to your friends and tell them how much the Lord has done for you and how he has had mercy on you." And he, the demon-possessed man, went away and began to proclaim in Decapolis how much Jesus had done for him, and everyone marveled. We've heard that story before. In this story, Jesus was able to heal a man who was demon-possessed. I mentioned this morning, they're real. This guy didn't have one. He had many. He had these demons inside of him. The townspeople had tried to chain him up. They had tried to do things to keep him from hurting himself and doing things, but they were unsuccessful, so they had just given up on helping him. Pretty much banished him. "Hey, just stay out there in the tombs. Just live out there with all the dead people. You're not going to bother them. Just stay away from us. Stay out there." Jesus came in, and he cast the demons completely out and healed this man. See, Jesus knew, hey, this man needs help. I'm going to pursue this man. But I want you to notice one thing. And as I was studying, this is what got me excited about this. As I was studying this, there was something. You ever read scripture 100 times and you get something new all of a sudden? All right, this story, I've heard it 100 times. Casting Crown has a big song about it. I've sang the song. I've read the story. I've heard people talk about it. But I've never heard this. And it just amazed me. I want you to notice what Jesus did to pursue this one man. Jesus crossed the lake. It's the start of a new chapter, so we forget what happened in chapter 4. Jesus crossed the lake. You see, this was a big lake. It was 13 miles long and 8 miles wide. And remember that they weren't in motorized boats. As they were in these boats that they were in, they had to sit there and crank their arms on these oars and try to row and paddle across this big lake that they were going across. And if you look at the verses before this in chapter 4, we'll find that they even experienced a life-threatening storm while they were trying to cross over. I don't think the devil was too happy that Jesus was headed over to his man, to his legion. Those in the boat with Jesus, they were experienced on boats. They knew how to handle things. But as you read the story of chapter 4, they were scared and they thought, hey, we're all going to die. But Jesus was willing to cross this dangerous lake. And the Bible in chapter 4 tells us he was even asleep at the bottom of the boat during this storm while everybody else was panicking. And you remember the last verse of chapter 4? The last verse of chapter 4, I'm in the wrong place here, but it says, they marveled, what kind of man can do this, that even the winds and the rain obey his voice as they go across this lake. I want you to get this, understand this. Jesus pursued this one man across the lake. Because I want you to see something. Why would Jesus cross? Why would Jesus go through this storm? Why would he go over there to pursue this one man? I want you to notice that he healed the man. And then he went back across the lake. The people said, leave here, don't stay here. So Jesus got back in the boat and went back across the lake. Jesus' entire reason for crossing that lake was for one man. Now listen. Again, I've read that story 100 times. You may have already seen that and got that, but this was like a light bulb that went off on me when I was reading that. I've read the story and heard it preached about, you know, Jesus in the bottom of the boat and panicking and causing all this stuff to calm down. And then I've heard separate stories about the demon-possessed man over here. But I never put that together. That Jesus crossed the lake, healed one man, and then went back across the lake for one person. He relentlessly pursued it. You see, everyone else had given up on this man. Everyone else had kicked him out of their towns. Everyone else had tried to restrain him with chains. And yet Jesus relentlessly pursues him. He goes after him. What did it cost for this man's freedom? The lives of 2,000 pigs. But it was just pigs, right? So who cares? But I want you to think about something in this story again. Research says that the average price to raise one pig was about $600. Raising 2,000 pigs together might bring the price down a little bit, and so they estimate that to raise these pigs was $400 per pig. So it would still be $800,000 worth of pigs that Jesus just sent into the water. $800,000 worth. According to Jesus, the freedom of one man was worth over $800,000. It was worth more than that. Jesus relentlessly pursued this man at all costs to bring healing. And I want you to understand, listen, here's the point. Here's what I want you to get at. Listen, Jesus is relentlessly pursuing you and I as well. Whatever issue that you're going through in your life, the struggles that you have, the decisions that you have to make that, oh, no one understands, no one cares, no one knows even what's happening in my life. Jesus knows. That's why he crossed the lake. He's crossing the lake for you. Just like this man, you and I, we have a problem that no one can fix. I'm assuming none of you are possessed by demons. I don't think you are. But see, I think it's something that's worse. Worse than demons? Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." You've sinned, I've sinned. We've all sinned. We fall short of God's glory. And the end result is our death. Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin..." We have sinned, all of us have sinned, and our wages for sin, the payment for our sin, is death. The Bible tells us this. But the Bible also says that Jesus chose to relentlessly pursue us to bring healing in our lives. He says this in Luke chapter 19. He says, "For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost." That's why he came. He came for you and me. We were lost. Some of you right now are still lost. And I'm not necessarily saying, oh, you're a sinner and that you're just, you know, you've never had salvation. Some of you are just lost. There's decisions and things that are coming in your life that you're not following, that you're just, oh, I don't know what to do. I don't know how to. And Jesus said, listen, I come to help you. I'm here to help. You're lost? Hey, I'm here to help you get found. Jesus came to seek after us, to rescue us. To what extremes has Jesus gone through in pursuing you? Think about your life for a minute. Think about all the stupid things you've done. Oh, and Jesus still came after you. Oh, I messed up here, and I messed up here, and I did this. I was young. I was in high school. It was this. Listen. Jesus still came after you. It doesn't matter what it was that you did. He might not have crossed a dangerous lake. As I mentioned this morning, he left the greatest place ever to come after you. To come after me. He was sitting on the throne right next to God. And he gets up, straightens his sweater. All right, let's go. Darren needs help. Stuart needs help. John needs help. Brittany needs help. Olivia needs help. He said, here we go. Let's do it. And he took off and he went after it. He went from being worshipped by millions to experience the pain of mankind. Pursuing you didn't cost the lives of 2,000 pigs. Pursuing you cost Jesus his life. Someone had to pay the penalty for your sins. And remember, when we read in Romans, the penalty of the sins is death. So Jesus chose to lay down his life, to take on your penalty, to die in your place. He chose to do these things for you and I. Why? Why did Jesus do this? He relentlessly pursued you to bring you freedom from your sins. Have you experienced that freedom from your sins? Oh, yeah, Darren, I'm a Christian. Okay, let me ask you again. Have you experienced that freedom from your sins? Darren, I'm a Christian. Okay, let me ask you again. Have you experienced the freedom from your sins? If you will stop running, if you'll surrender to Jesus like this man did, Jesus will take you from living among the dead to true life with God. That's what he wants to do. You see, we understand in John 10:10, it says, the thief comes only to steal and to kill and to destroy. But Jesus said, I have come that they may have life and have it abundantly. The devil wants to do all this evil to you. Jesus says, I want you to have abundant life. Maybe like this man, listen, everyone has given up on you. Or at least you feel that way. But not Jesus. You see, to Jesus, you were worth giving up his life for. Maybe you're bound by an addiction. Maybe you're bound by your sins, and Jesus wants to give you freedom from those things. When you look at the story of the lost sheep and the lost coin, there was a celebration when it was found. Talked about that a little bit this morning. And listen, tonight, heaven's waiting to celebrate. I can see them sitting on the edge. You ever sit on the edge of your seat? If you're a sports fan, you have. You sit on the edge of your seat and you're watching. They're watching. And they're like, do it, do it, do it, do it. Yeah! And they get all excited. I wanted to do a cartwheel, but I didn't. But they get excited. Listen, they're excited because that one thing that was lost is now found. That thing that Jesus gave his life for is now found. Heaven is ready to throw a party with a banner hanging up with your name on it. But you see, heaven is waiting for you to stop running and surrender to the one who relentlessly loves you. I'm going to say this again. But Darren, I'm a Christian. Have you surrendered it to God? But Darren, I'm a Christian. Have you surrendered it and given it to God the way that you're supposed to? Relentless, unstoppable, energized, enduring, never giving up, always on. That's the way that God pursues you and me. He's after us. Where are you at? How will you respond to his pursuit? I don't know why, but I'm going to say it one more time. But Darren, I'm a Christian. How are you going to respond to his pursuit, Christian? Sinner, whoever you are, how will you respond to it? Would you stand with me? God, I thank you that you never gave up on me. God, I don't have the testimony that some of these guys have, and they live their life and did some crazy things that were just far away from you. But God, as I look back over my life, I wasn't perfect. God, I had a violent temper. I did things, said things that hurt people. God, I had a lot of people at my church fooled about me being this preacher's kid that was, he's a pretty good guy. But God, you knew the truth and you never stopped pursuing me. God, I thank you for that. God, tonight, if there's someone here that needs to come and talk to you and say, God, listen. Thank you for pursuing me. Thank you for forgiving me of my sins. God, help for me to do better. God, if there's someone here tonight that has never accepted you as their Savior, God, help for them to realize and understand that you are relentlessly pursuing them. We're going to sing one verse of invitation. If you need to come to the altar, you come to the altar tonight. Don't wait. Don't hold back, but do that tonight.
God, make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you. Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever true.
You ask God to change your heart.
Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you. You are the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me, this is what I pray. My heart, oh God, make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God, may I be like you.
God, we thank you for the story that we could look at tonight. God, help for us to be grateful that you pursue us. Help for us to be grateful for what Jesus did on the cross for us. God, how can we relentlessly pursue you till we understand how much you gave for us? So God, help for us to do those things, to know those things, to understand how much you love us, how much you've given for us. God, be with us this week. Give us opportunities to share. Give us opportunities to present the gospel to someone. God, we thank you for your love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you for being here tonight. You're dismissed.